بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد Alhamdulillah, brothers and sisters, this month we have been talking about families. And we've been focusing on making sure that we're trying to encompass all different areas when we're talking about how we should be dealing with our families. We started talking about the significance of what it means to have a family, what that actually means. And we talked about problems that arise within this family structure and how what is the proper way to approach and solve these problems. And we spoke explicitly about domestic violence and those kinds of issues. With this last Jummah in this month that we're talking about, specifically about families, I want to close with one very, very important piece of advice. And that is to be someone in your family that encourages your family. And how you can be in that position, whether you are a father, the mother, a parent, whether you're a child, whether you're a sibling, in this family structure, you as an individual can be someone that has an impact on other members of your family. And you can have an influence on other members of your family. And we've spoken about this in detail in previous khutbahs, but I want to highlight this point again, as Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فَذَكِّرْ وَإِنَّ ذِكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ Remind, because the reminder is beneficial to the faithful. Reminders, constantly hearing things over and over again, is something that is beneficial to the faithful. So we want to be people in our families that have an impact on our families. We want to have a positive impact on our family, not a negative impact. And that's what we've talked about before this entire month. So how can we demonstrate for our families? How can we be the individual in our family that is having an influence in our family structure? How can we try to move our families to something more positive? If there is, you know, there is dysfunction, or if there is tension within a family, if there's an issue that's taking place, how can you solve this particular issue? And while every specific situation has its specific circumstances, there definitely are principles that we are taught within our faith to utilize to make sure that whatever the situation is in our families, that we are at least tackling it with these principles. It should have, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, should have a positive outcome. And we want to look at ourselves as an individual in terms of having an impact on other people in our family from three different perspectives. And the first one we'll talk about in the greatest amount of detail. And these three perspectives are, number one, setting a good example for other members of your family. The second part is building a relationship, a real relationship with members of your family. When we use the word relationship, sometimes we just stop at the fact that we're related by blood, that's our relationship, right? I married this person, that's my relationship. I'm a parent to this person, I'm a sibling to this person, that's my relationship. That's not what we mean by building a relationship. The relationship starts when you recognize this is somebody that I care about, this is somebody that I'm responsible for, my family, but how do I connect? How do I connect with this person? And that's what we call a relationship. So having, you know, being a good example to members of your family, building a good relationship with the members of your family, and the third aspect of this is actually giving instruction, advice, speaking, communicating to members of our families in a good positive way. All of these things together and in this order, this is how we can make good positive change. And it first and foremost starts by setting the example. How many times have we been in situations with our families when there's something tense or there is an argument and we bring up a point, right? We want to say, this is the right thing to do. And so many times you'll be confronted with, you don't act that way yourself. That's not how what you did. That's not what you said. That's not how you reacted. This is something that happens in argumentations that we have with our family members, right? A parent will tell the child, don't behave in this way, it's wrong. And the child will say, well, you do it. You would be surprised how often children notice what we do, the things that we do. Example we give sometimes is parents that tell their kids, you shouldn't lie. Never tell a lie. You shouldn't lie. Lying is bad. If you lie to me, it's a horrible thing. Lying is a sin, so on and so forth. And then you get a call from somebody you don't want to talk to, and you're, you know, your kid brings you your phone, and you're like, oh, tell them I'm not here. Tell them I'm in the bathroom. Tell them I'm outside. Right? And then the child recognizes this. They say, you tell me not to lie, but you lie. And so when they lie to you and you confront them, they'll say, you do it too. You tell lies all the time. Setting a good example is the number one thing we have to do in order to have a positive impact on our families. One of the things we can do, and it's even right here in the masjid on the day of Jummah, and something we need to do better care of inshallah as a community, is our kids. Our kids that come and attend the Jummah prayer. How can we teach them how they should behave when the khutbah is being given, and you know what they're supposed to do? What are the adab of the Jummah? Have them sit down with you. Make sure your kids, when they're here in the masjid, that they're sitting with you. That they're sitting with you. Because at that moment, you're setting an example. You're setting an example for your children that when we come to the masjid for Jummah, this is how we behave. And your child is next to you, and if they're playing around, you just touch them on the hand, you grab them, you give them that look that only a father or mother can give, and you remind them without saying a word that this is what you're supposed to do, this is how you behave in the masjid. Setting an example is extremely important. And how do we become a good example? How do we set a good example? And being an example means when somebody else in your family looks at you, they're understanding what you represent. What is it that you speak for? What is it that you stand up for? What are those things? And some of the ways we set a good example, and we'll take a look at this, is number one, by being someone who is kind, not aggressive, not negative, not someone who is hurtful or judgmental, but being kind, being generous. And this is something that the Prophet ﷺ has taught us many, many times over in many of his ahadith. For example, in one of them, the Prophet ﷺ said, يَسِّرُوا وَلَا تُعَسِّرُوا وَبَشِّرُوا وَلَا تُنَفِّرُوا. General, hadith for dealing with people. And again, we say all of these teachings that we have in our faith for dealing with people, they first and foremost apply to our families. So he said, يَسِّرُوا وَلَا تُعَسِّرُوا. He said, make things easy, do not create difficulties for people. And think about your relationships that you have in the home. Sometimes when there's an issue that's tense and words get exchanged, what do? Do we try to make things easy on the other person? Or do we try to purposefully say things that will hurt the other person? Do we try to purposefully do things that will create obstacles for them to accomplish what they want to accomplish on a regular day? How do we react when we're upset with our family members? Do we make things easy or do we make things difficult because we're upset? So he said, يَسِّرُوا وَلَا تُعَسِّرُوا. In general, this is a principle the Prophet ﷺ said, make things easy, don't create difficulties for people. بَشِّرُوا وَلَا تُنَفِّرُوا. Give good news. Say good things to people. Don't drive them away with negativities and negative things. This is a principle that we need to adopt in our household. That when we want to deal with our families, we're showing them. As an example, I am somebody who makes things easy for you. I don't create difficulties even when I'm upset. I'm somebody that will use good words. I'm somebody that's not going to... The Prophet said, بَشِّرُوا وَلَا تُنَفِّرُوا. It's interesting, right? He said, say good words. Bashara is giving good news. And then he said, وَلَا تُنَفِّرُوا. تُنَفِّرُوا means don't drive people away. Right? Don't drive people away. And so why? Because negative words drive people away, and we know that judgment, yelling, speaking in an angry voice, these things, what do they do to the person you're talking to? That person becomes defensive and they're no longer listening to what you're saying. They're trying to run away. Even if they're standing right in front of you, their mind is not with you. And subhanAllah, the Prophet ﷺ said, Bashiru, say good words, وَلَا تُنَفِّرُوا, don't drive people away. By using negative words and using these negative emotions. So being kind and not negative. And the Prophet ﷺ also said, وَيُعْجِبُنِ الْفَأْلُ صَالِحِ الْكَلِمَةُ الْحَسَنَ. That optimism is pleasing to me. I like optimism. And I like that people use good words. The Prophet ﷺ said this, right? And again, it's a general thing he's teaching us. When you're in your household, when you're dealing with the members of your family, be optimistic and not pessimistic. And this is a hard one for parents to try to swallow, right? And again, I'm a parent as well, we know this. This is something that happens. That being optimistic, assuming the best of our family members can be difficult at times. But this is something, if anything, think that this makes the Prophet ﷺ happy. He said, يُعْجِبُنِي. This makes me happy. I like it. I'm amazed when I see people that are optimistic. And he said this in reference to people that are always speaking negatively. That, oh, this happened, that means this bad thing's going to happen. Or the clouds came, that means, oh, my day is going to be like this. He said, no, يُعْجِبُنِ الْفَأْلُ صَالِحِ. I like people to give good interpretations to things, right? And I like people to use good words. So always be kind. Try your best to be kind. We know it's like always is a big word to use as well. In general, this is how we should be with our families. Part of setting a good example for our families is patience, is showing sabr. And the Arabic word sabr, which we translate as patience, and what patience is understood as is something different, we need to differentiate between the two. The word sabr in Arabic, it means restraint. It means restraint. Patience in English, we use it in terms of like waiting, right? So if your child is bothering you and you're doing something and you're like, be patient. What you're telling the child to do is wait, right? If you're busy with something and someone wants to talk to you, you're like, just be patient. I'll be with you in a second. We use it to mean wait. So when we constantly use the word sabr and we relate it with the word patience, we're missing something out. Because patience, we're generally using it to mean wait. Sabr means restraint. It means restraint. When we spoke about domestic violence, one of the things that happens with domestic violence victims, people that are being abused, when they go to get help, people tell them, have sabr, be patient. And they mean like, be patient, have sabr. You know, show restraint, you're going through something tough. And this is quite the opposite of what needs to be, or the person who needs to be told. It's the abuser who's violating, they're the ones that need to be told, have sabr, show restraint. If you're getting angry, show restraint. If you're losing control, have sabr, show restraint. We have to understand, and this is when we misunderstand what the word means, we misuse it at times as well. The person who should have sabr, restraint, is the person who's going to go overboard and do things that are wrong. But having that restraint within our families, being people that can tolerate a lot, take in a lot, and then, you know, think before we act when it comes to our families, especially as parents in the household. Especially as parents in the household, and I'm not just talking about parents and kids, I'm talking about parents, the spouses with each other. Having sabr, having restraint, and having sabr with the words that we use. Having sabr with the way we look at each other. Having sabr with the way we approach each other, and so on and so forth. And the Prophet ﷺ, he described sabr in context with other things. He said, وَالصَّلَاةُ نُورُ وَالصَّدَقَةُ بُرْهَانُ وَالصَّبْرُ ضِيَاءُ. That salah, the prayer that we do, is a nur, it's a light. It's a very bright light. And he said, وَالصَّدَقَةُ بُرْهَانُ. Giving in charity is a proof of your faith. If you can take your money and give it to somebody else who really needs it, this is a proof that you have faith. And he said, وَالصَّبْرُ ضِيَاءُ. And sabr is a different kind of light. There's nur, which is, you know, a light that we have, that we see right now in this room. This can be described as nur. And diya is the light that the light of the sun has been used to describe. It's a much brighter light. Diya. It's a light that also has heat, right? We know that diya is a light that also has heat. It's the light that's used in terms of the sun. That wa diya and wa shamsa diya, and that the sun is like a diya. And so the sabr is it's not just something that emanates from you. It's something that has an impact that affects things that are around it. So your restraint has an impact on the situations that you're being restrained with, that you're showing restraint with. So showing sabr is something that is huge. And the Prophet ﷺ said, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ خَيْرٌ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٌ وَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ لِأَحَدٍ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّاءٌ شَكَرٌ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ دَرَّاءٌ صَبَرٌ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. The Prophet ﷺ said that the state of the believer is just awesome. It's amazing. And this is for nobody else but the believer. Now, when the Prophet ﷺ says this, and we're like, we're believers, right? We're believers, we think that this is, he's talking about us. But he categorizes this. He says, this is how the believer behaves. And now we have to take a look. The Prophet ﷺ is speaking, now we have to see, does this apply to us? And so he says, every affair of the believer is good. Every affair. And this is for no one but the believer. Why? If something good happens to the believer, shakara. He says, you know, alhamdulillah. He shows great gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is next month's theme, because we all know what's coming up next month, right? Gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When good things happen, they're happy, and they're thankful, and they're grateful. And when negative things happen to the believer, sabara. He shows restraints. Restraint. And again, we use the word restraint, not the word patience. Why? Because the believer doesn't just wait, right? Allah azza wa jalla doesn't tell you, if you're going through bad situations, wait. If things aren't working out, wait. That's not what he's saying. You're always looking for a solution, but with restraint. You don't want to cross those lines and hurt people and violate other people's rights. You want to be very mindful of which path you're taking to provide solutions. The Prophet ﷺ was being abused in Mecca. And all the time Allah Azza wa Jalla is planning his migration from Mecca to Medina. And sabr is a part of that. Restraint is a part of that, right? It wasn't just waiting around, not making any plans, not doing anything, just seeing what will happen. That's not sabr. It's restraint. It's finding a solution, but keeping yourself in check. And the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا الصَّبْرُ عِنْدَ صَدْمَةِ الْأُولَىٰ. That patience, or this sabr, you realize it at the onset of difficulty. It's very easy to say, you know, somebody walks up, you know, in your family and they say, you know, dad, I've done something horrible. And then you slap your child, right? And then later on you're like, okay, now I'm going to be patient. Now I'm going to show sabr. That's not sabr. Sabr in the sadmatul ula, when you get struck with that calamity, that's when you show sabr. That's when you show restraint. So when your child comes and says something they did, and they tell you something they did that was that you don't like, and you show restraint, remember, a sabrul diya, that sabr has a light. It emanates a light with heat. It has an impact. Your restraint will have an impact at that moment. Your ability to think before you act will have an impact in that moment, and we need to keep this in mind when we're being kind and patient with our families. Another aspect of being kind and gentle with our families is, or setting a good example, is keeping our promise. A lot of times we tell our families things and then we don't keep that word. I will be there for this, I will call you back at this time, I'll make sure I get the groceries or I'll get everything on the list. Simple little things even like that. But these are things that set a good example. Because if you have to confront things in your family where things are not being done properly, you have to be that good example. The majority of your experience with these people should be that this is somebody that always keeps their word. And I didn't keep my word, so when they tell me you didn't keep your word, it has an impact. It has an impact on me. And the Prophet ﷺ, again, he said, Ayatul munafiqi thalath. The signs of a hypocrite are three. And even outside of the context of the family, these are things we have to be very, very mindful of. And this is again the Prophet ﷺ speaking. And if we find these within ourselves, we ask Allah to pardon and forgive. And we ask ourselves to show that restraint and correct ourselves. The Prophet ﷺ said, Ayatul munafiqi thalath. Idha haddatha kadhiba. When he speaks, he lies. وَإِذَا وَعَدَ أَخْلَفَ. When he makes a promise, he goes back. He goes back on his promise. وَإِذَا تُمِنَ خَانَ. And when he is entrusted with something, he betrays that trust. And these are beautiful words of the Prophet ﷺ. If you just take this one hadith and you implement this in your family, subhanAllah, you will see changes. Especially the last two portions. Right? Most of us, alhamdulillah, inshallah, every time we speak, we're not lying. Right? But when we make promises, we should not break those promises. And a promise, by the way, there's a serious promise when you use the words, I promise or I swear that I will do this. That's a very, very serious high-level promise. There are other promises we make all the time. And when we speak to our families and we speak to them that when they say, Dad, will you be there for this? And Dad says, yes, I will be there. That's a promise. That's a promise. That's a promise that you're giving a commitment to someone that you're going to. If you can't, say, I can't. You don't have to please people by saying you will be there and only let them down later on. And when that son entrusts the father that my father said he will be there, and he puts that trust in him, وَإِذَا تُمِنَ خَانَ, but he betrays that trust. He betrays and he's not there when he said he would be there. These are all things that hurt. These are all things that hurt. And we set bad examples for our family when we can't be people that are kind, patient, showing sabr, restraint, and people that keep their promises. And last but not least, and we can't even get to the other ones because of time, but we'll stick to the example part, is really living with love with our families. Really genuinely showing love to our families. And this is something we have to kind of dig deep into our hearts. Once again, especially if you know we've had families and we've been married for 10, 20 years. If our children are, you know, 15, 20 years old, that's a very long time. If you spent 15, 20 years in something, that's a lot of experience. You're a master at that, right? But for families, subhanAllah, we can't seem to fix anything, right? It seems like we're just always struggling. It's been 30 years, oh, that's even more struggle, right? The longer the years get, the worse the jokes get about the husband and the wife, right? That's just how it happens. But this is something we have to be very mindful of, that learning to really love our families and show love to our families. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna rifqa la yakunu fi shay'in illa zanahu." وَلَا يُنْزَعُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا شَانَهُ. And this goes back to the point of being kind and gentle. But rifq is also comes from love. He said that gentleness is not found in anything except that it beautifies it. It makes it so much more beautiful. And gentleness is not removed from anything except that it will make it defective. It will make it defective. And this is another one of those principles that we have to apply when we're dealing with our families. If we're not gentle, if we can't be kind, if we're seen as always stern and firm and, you know, always the disciplinarian. If we can't be kind and gentle, this is problematic. Because this is not, if we have gentleness in something, the Prophet ﷺ is saying, it will make it better. It will make it more beautiful. Adopt that as a principle when you're speaking and dealing with your families. Just be gentle. Take a deep breath. If you can't be gentle at that time, and this is, you know, a whole different set of topic here. If you can't be gentle at that time, that's not the time to have that conversation. That's not the time to deal with that situation. Take a breather. Step back. Step away. And then take that time to really calm down and then come back and have that gentleness with your family. The Prophet ﷺ one time was sitting with his grandsons, Al-Hasan wa Al-Husayn radiallahu anhuma, and he was kissing them. He picked up his grandsons and he was showing them love and he was kissing them. And one of the men from the other tribes, he said, "Do you kiss your children?" He asked the Prophet ﷺ this. He says, "Do you kiss your children? أَتُقَبِّلُونَ صِبْيَانَكُمْ? Do you kiss your children?" And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Yes, I do." And he said, "I have tens and tens of children." He had lots of kids. "And I haven't ever kissed one of them ever. I've never kissed one of them ever." And this is the hadith. This is the part of the hadith that you're familiar with. "Man la yarhamu la yurham." The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever does not show mercy, compassion, will not be shown mercy and compassion by Allah. And we're familiar with this part of the hadith. "Man la yarhamu la yurham." Whoever is not compassionate, Allah will not be compassionate with him. We're familiar with that part. But this is the context with where that hadith came. When he was kissing his children, showing love to them, and someone said, "I never do this with my kids." And he said to him, "You're not showing them compassion. Allah will not show you compassion. God will not show you mercy if you can't be compassionate." And another instance has happened when somebody came to his house and he was playing with his kids and he was kissing his kids. And he said again, "أَتُقَبِّلُونَ صِبْيَانَكُمْ? You kiss your children?" And he said, "Yes." And he said, we don't do that. In our families, in our tribes, we don't kiss our children." And the Prophet ﷺ said a very powerful thing. He said, "What am I to do if Allah has removed mercy and compassion from your hearts? What can I do?" And this is a serious thing that he is saying, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you would not even show compassion to your kids. What can I do about that? If Allah has removed, that doesn't mean you have a lack. If you can't even show love to your children, that Allah has removed mercy from your heart. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make sure that mercy and compassion stay in our hearts, it increases in our hearts, and that we are those that are able to inject generosity and gentleness in every affair of our lives. And this is especially important when we're dealing with our families. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِلِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ ذَنْبٍ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ